Assalamu alaikum. Welcome to the new lecture. So in this lecture we'll be discussing about the comparison of the two shunt compensators, that is the state pump and the SVC. So as we have discussed earlier, that in the linear operating range of the VI characteristics, the functional compensation capability, that is the compensation that is provided by both STATCOM and SVC, are typically similar. You will see that both of them are trying to maintain the voltage at the reference value. You can see that in the VI characteristics of both the compensators, we have a horizontal line which is parallel to the x-axis, or we can say which is parallel to the current axis. So that is similar to the both. But the operating principle of the STATCOM, which is actually based on the converter based VAR generator, it functions as a shunt connected synchronous voltage source, in which actually it draws the current. The voltage source try to draw a current which is in quadrature to this to the generated voltage of this STATCOM, and it will be definitely different from those of the SVC, which is thyristor control reactors and thyristor switch capacitors that function as a shunt connected controlled reactive admittances. So where we have to change the admittances only. So in the STATCOM, we actually change the voltage source, change the magnitude of the current that is drawn by the voltage source, and the angle, we try to keep it always in quadrature. So this basic operational difference, that's voltage source versus the reactive admittance, accounts for the STATCOM's overall superior functional characteristics, better performance and greater application flexibility than those attainable with the SVC. These operational and performance characteristics are summarized here. We'll summarize them one by one with the underlying physical reasons behind them. So we have proper reasons why we are going for one instead of other, and with the corresponding application benefits. We'll see all these. So the first one is the VI and VQ characteristics. The STATCOM can operate over its full output current range at very low, ideally to be zero. At zero voltage, it will still be able to draw its maximum current. But typically, as we have seen, it may be 0.15 to 0.12 per unit system voltage level. So, in other words, the maximum capacitive or inductive output current of the STATCOM can be maintained independent of the system voltage. That is the main advantage of the STATCOM. So, its output current is, you can say, independent of the system voltage. And maximum VAR generator, that is the voltage multiplied by this current, since current is constant. So this VAR generation will depend upon the voltage in a linear relation, or absorption change linearly with this AC system voltage. As voltage changes, you can say this reactive power will change, because this reactive power will be equal to the current drawn multiplied to voltage across it. So, but in case of SVC, which is composed of the thyristor switch capacitors and reactors, it becomes a fixed capacitive admittance at the full output. So in that case, the maximum attainable compensating current of the SVC decreases linearly with the AC system voltage, because this current is dependent upon the voltage, it becomes a constant capacitance. And this maximum VAR output, that is the reactive power, which is equal to V square divided by XC or V square into BC, decreases with the square of this voltage. This is shown here. So this is for this is the practical VI characteristics, or we can say a realistic VI characteristics of the STATCOM. You can see up to, let us say, 0.15, it acts as a capacitor as well, but up beyond 0.15, it is capable of drawing the exactly same current, IC max current, at all the voltages from 0.15 to 1 per unit. So these parallel lines to this, that is, this is the linear operating range from this point to this point. This is the linear operating range from this point to this point. You can see these are similar, as we have discussed in the first slide. So these are different references from this and this. You can change the reference and we can go accordingly. For example, from this point to this point, and its linear operating range will be this if its reference is 0.7 volt, 0.7 per unit. So you can see here, current is constant from this to this, but here current is increasing or decreasing as voltage decreases from, you can say, 1 per unit to 0 per unit. So for the VQ characteristics, we have voltage over here, we have Q over here. Since here Q is equal to current multiplied by voltage, as current, as voltage decreases, this reactive power will also decrease because it will depend upon the value of voltage as current is constant. For this case, since this, the current itself depend upon the voltage, you can see from here, the reactance, the reactive power depends upon the square of the voltage, because reactive power will be now equal to V square divided by XC. So it depends, it is a linear relationship. We can say as voltage decreases more, there is a more decrease in the reactive power. You can say in case of this SVC, in general, it is not there when it is required. At that time, V square by XC is very less, but it provides more reactive power when it is not required. When voltage is at the this reference value, at that time, it supplies a more reactive power V square by, because V is at the relative value, but at that time, it is not required. So the STATCOM is therefore superior to the SVC in providing the voltage support under large system disturbances, during which the voltage excursion would be well outside the linear operating range of the compensator. In that case, it provides a good support of the voltage, even if it is beyond the linear operating range of the compensator. You can see from here to here, if we choose any value from here to here, you will see the voltage support for this case will be more as compared to this case. Because here, when you draw a line from this point to this point, or a line which is the voltage from this point to this point, the voltage for this case will be less as compared to this case, because it is providing more reactive current, capacitive current, as compared to this. Providing more reactive current means it is providing more reactive power, and it is enhancing the voltage more as compared to the SVC. The capability of providing maximum compensating current at reduced system voltage enables the STATCOM to perform in a variety of applications the same dynamic compensation as an SVC of considerably higher rating. That means we can still have an SVC which can do the same work as that of STATCOM, but that SVC should be a higher rating. So that is why we can go for the STATCOM, which can also do the same we can say work as that of done by the SVC, but the STATCOM required for this case, which the SVC is doing, the rating would be now lower. That is one more advantage of the STATCOM. So these are discussed. Now let us discuss about the transient stability, that is improved, or we can say what will happen to the transient stability if we use the STATCOM or SVC. So we have here used a STATCOM, here we have used an SVC. At the middle of the line, you can see this is V at angle of minus delta by 2. Here it will be Vm at an angle of 0, it will be here. So plus delta by 2, this will be minus delta by 2. So that total angle between this and this will be delta. So let us say we have a middle point. At this point, this angle, this voltage will be equal to Vm at an angle of 0. That's why we have shown it like this. So this P is equal to twice V square by X sine of delta by 2, that is this curve. It will be an ideal, it will be for the ideal compensator. So since this is not an ideal compensator, STATCOM is a realistic compensator or practical compensator, this is, it will not follow this curve. The STATCOM will also not follow this curve. You can see that this is the curve without compensator, is power is given by V square by X sine of delta. This is this value, and the value that is given by the STATCOM in presence of this, it will be modified this curve as this, that is V square by X sine of delta plus V into IQ, which I have derived earlier, IQ max divided by 2 into sine of delta by 2. We have derived it. So for different values of IQ, this will be one curve. Let's say IQ is equal to this 0.5. This will be IQ will be equal to 1.0. This will be IQ is equal to 1.5. Okay. We may have another curve from here to here. Let us say that is here, which we already drawn, it will be equal to IQ is equal to minus 0.5. Similarly, this curve is again for the, this is the explanation for the SVC, we have actually done it before. This is for the value of the ideal compensator given by this. So this is the uncompensated system. Now this will be when we have here an SVC which has some capacitance. We can say SVC containing capacitance as well as inductance. So these curves are when we are using it in the capacitive mode. So from here a constant capacitance will be there, but here the capacitance will be less as compared to this. That is VC1 max will be less than VC2 max, will be less than VC3 max, it will be more. So assuming that this maximum will be equal to this maximum will be equal to, say, this maximum, this point will be equal to this point. And after you can see that how the variation of these curves is done. You can see finally these curves will meet at pi, but these curves will go away from the pi as well. So they will not meet at pi. They will be slightly looking parallel to each other. They will meet outside. They will not meet. They will go outside the pi. I have drawn it earlier. So based on this, we'll now discuss about the transient stability. As you know, that transient stability is dependent upon the area under the curve. So that is what we have done over here. Let us say we have a fault at this point. So three-phase fault, total electrical power will go to zero, and we are clearing the fault at this, that is delta C. So this much of area that is coming under this will be used to accelerate the rotor. And when rotor accelerates, there will be an increase in delta. That's why delta increases from delta 1 to delta C. So when this happens, let us say fault is cleared at this point. Now this area and this area is same because P1 and P0 for this case and P1 for P0 for this case is same. Now here you can see, since this curve is going, we can say the area under this curve and this curve, you can see, is this much, they are parallel to each other, but this curve for this case is actually meeting this point at pi. That means the area under this curve will be less as compared to this. That means you can see the sweeping area for this case is more as compared to this. So let us say we have computed the area, and this decelerating area is from this point to this point, and decelerating area from here is this point to this point. Definitely they have to be same, this case for this case as for this case. But sweeping the same area here and here, you see it will do it by sweeping less amount of the angle, that is less delta. Here also, but here it has to cover the same area for greater delta. So that means here the swing will be for more time, here the swing will be for less time. So the area which is left for the swimming sweeping, that means the margin for the sweeping or the margin for the stability is this much, and the margin for stability is very small. We can say the transient stability for the static is more as compared to SVC. So definitely it will be more as compared to the uncompensated system. So generally you can just remember this, that if area is more, the transient stability is more. You can see we have computed these two curves. Here the area under this curve is more as compared to this curve. Definitely this will be more stable. So this is about the transient stability, and this is about the static. Now we'll discuss about the response time. So the response time for the STATCOM is less than 200 microseconds to 350 microseconds, and for SVC it is 2.5 to 5 milliseconds. So it is definitely the STATCOM is faster as well as compared to the SVC. So I think this is enough for this STATCOM. Now we can say overall STATCOM plus SVC, they are used to regulate the voltage, and they are, you can say, shunt compensations. They are used for the shunt compensation, reactive power control or voltage control. Now we'll move to the series compensation. So why do we go for the series compensation? There is obvious reason. So earlier we saw that the reactive shunt compensation is highly effective in maintaining the desired voltage profile or in controlling the reactive power along the transmission line interconnecting the two bus of AC system and providing the support to the end voltage of radial lines in the face of increasing power demand. So the reactive shunt compensation, when applied at sufficiently closed intervals along the line, that means if we increase the number of compensators in the line, so it could theoretically make it possible to transfer power up to the thermal limit of the line. So we can go up to the thermal limit of the line, so we can increase the stability limit and we can meet the thermal limit if a large enough angle is kept between the two voltages, which can be established. So since we know that this power is dependent upon the sign of delta, that angle has to be increased. However, the shunt compensation is ineffective in controlling the actual transmission power at a defined transmission voltage, because it is ultimately determined by the series line impedance. You can see this P is equal to V square by X sine of delta. Definitely it is dependent upon the V, but ultimately it is directly related to the, or we can say it is directly more effectively changed by the series line impedance and angle between the end voltage of the line. So it was recognized that AC power transmission over the long lines was primarily limited by the series reactive impedance of the line. So we can say that the shunt compensation is generally used for the voltage control or reactive power control, but series compensation is directly used to control the or to change the real power. Series capacitor compensation was introduced decades ago to cancel the portion of the reactive line impedance and thereby increase the transmittable power. Subsequently, within the FACTS initiative, it has been demonstrated that variable series compensation, because FACTS give you the option that we may have the variable series compensation, which is very highly effective in both controlling the power flow and improving the stability of the line. So that is the advantage of the FACTS. Now we will see what is the concept of the series capacitor compensation. Most of these things we have already done in the basics of series compensation. This may be the repetition of the same. The basic idea behind the series capacitor compensation is to decrease the overall effective series transmission impedance, that is X, from the sending end to receiving end in the relationship, that is P is equal to V square by X sine of delta, characterizing the power transmission over the single line. Okay, consider the two machine model analogous to shown to that shown in the compensation in the figure below. You can see over here, but this is a two machine model. We have a reactance over here, but we have divided the reactance into two parts. Similarly, we are compensating it with the capacitance, and we are again dividing this capacitance into two parts for the simplicity. And for with the series capacitor compensation line, which for convenience is assumed to be composed of two identical segments as illustrated in figure A, that is here. So we have shown it composed of two capacitor reactances of same value, and the phasor diagram is shown over here. We already drawn this phasor diagram, you can see over here. So this point is very important, because actually we are exploiting this property of the capacitors, and then we are going for the other we can say compensators, which does the same thing but in a different manner. Note that for the same end voltage, that means for this voltage and for this voltage, the magnitude of the total voltage of the series line inductance, the magnitude of the total, that is this Vx, is increased by the magnitude of the opposed voltage Vc developed across the series capacitor. This results from an increase in the line current. What does this mean? When both these voltages are same, since we have introduced a reactance, capacitor reactance in between, the total reactance will decrease. Now the current, that is over here, will increase, because this current will be equal to Vs minus Vr divided by the less reactive. When that is the case, this current will increase. When current increases, the voltage drop across this impedance, that is X, will increase. It will increase. Earlier it was only this, now it will increase. When this voltage drop increases, now these two capacitors will develop a voltage which will try to decrease this voltage, that is the voltage across this. That is why they are shown opposite to this. So this is very important explanation of this, because this property is actually exploited by the other compensator, which does the same thing which this capacitor done. That means we will try to insert a voltage source in series with the line that is actually opposed to the voltage drop across this. That means if that is the case for that voltage source, that means that will act as a capacitor in that case. So we'll discuss that, but I want you to make or to remember these things, because when we come to that compensator, we'll be using the same concept but in a different manner. So for this case, let us say this value will be equal to its magnitude will be equal to I into XC divided by 2. I into XC divided by 2 will be on this. From this point to this point, this will be equal to I into X effective divided by 2, its magnitude. So this will be equal to, this is V, this is delta by 2. It will be equal to V sine of delta by 2 will be equal to Ix effective divided by 2. When you calculate I from there, the I will be equal to twice I divided by 1 minus k into x, which is x effective sine of delta by 2. We have already derived it, that's why I have written here directly this value. So P, that is at this point, P will be equal to Vm into I, or it will directly be equal to this this voltage multiplied with this current into cos of delta by 2. So when you give the value of I and this, or Vm into I, because Vm will also be equal to V into cos of delta by 2 into I, that will be same. It comes out to be V square by x into 1 minus k sine of delta. So in that case, we are getting the value of this. So Q will be equal to I square xc. So when you square it and give the value of xc, so it comes out to be this value. So these are the plotting values. This goes P and Q, this is delta. So this is the value when K is equal to 0. This is the value of Q, that's QC. When K is equal to 0, this QC will be equal to 0. So here it gives us the value of P when QC is equal to 0. This curve and this curve, this is for P, this is for Q, will be given for K is equal to 0.2. And this curve and this curve is given for K is equal to 0.4. So the relationship between the real power P, series capacitor reactance, reactive power QC, and angle delta is shown plotted at various values of degree of series compensation K in figure 3. So I have shown it here. It can be observed that, as expected, the transmittable power rapidly increases with the degree of series compensation K. As it increases, power will also increase. Similarly, the reactive power supplied by the series capacitor also increases sharply with K. So the reactive power supplied by K also increases with K and varies with delta in a similar manner as the line reactive power. So a reactive power also depends upon the value of K, and also it depends upon the value of delta. So it changes with delta as the reactive power of the line change, because that is also equal to, without this term, that will be equal to V square by x 1 minus cos of delta. So its relationship will be similar to that of the reactive power of the line. Now we'll discuss about the improvement of the voltage stability by using this XC. Let us say we have a system that is the same, this system and this system is the same. The load here we have assumed to be equal to R, resistive load. We have XC, we have X, this is a compensatory reactant, that is XC, it may be variable. So when we draw the phasor diagram for this, let us say we have voltage VR. Since this is a resistance, current will be in phase to it, and this will be the voltage phasor, which will be perpendicular to it, and its value will be equal to JIX effective, where X effective is equal to X minus XC. So the summation of this voltage VR and this voltage will be equal to VS. So from this figure, this Ix effective is equal to square root of Vs square minus Vr square. That's very simple. This will be equal to I into X effective. This voltage phasor will be equal to this square minus this square root. So I will be equal to Vs square root of Vs square minus Vr square divided by X effective. The power across this, the power consumed by the resistance will be equal to Vr into I. That's Vr into I. So it will be equal to Vr is having a value of Vr. I has a value of V square minus V squared by X effective. So this is the value of real power that is consumed by this resistance. So squaring both sides will be equal to p square will be equal to v square minus vr square into vr square divided by x effective square. This is done just to avoid the square root. I will differentiate this equation with respect to vr. That means it will be equal to y speed. dp by dvr is equal to 1 by x effective square. So differentiating this, keeping this constant, will be equal to vr square minus vr into 2 vr plus keeping this constant vr square into minus 2 vr. You can also differentiate it with simply multiply this to this and this. So when you differentiate here, it will be vr square into vr square, it will be equal to 2 vr vr square, and minus this multiplied by this will be equal to vr is power 4. It will be, its differentiation will be equal to 4 vr cube. Finally, you will get the same value. So when you differentiate this this by keeping this constant, will be equal to vr square into its differentiation will be constant, it will be equal to minus 2 vr, will be like this. So this will be equal to 2 times vr into vr square, that is here, multiplied by 2 into vr cube minus, this will be equal to minus plus into minus is minus, vr square into 2 vr is 2 vr cube. So this and this will be equal to minus 4 vr cube, this will be equal to 2 vr vr square. So its value will be maximum, and this will be equal to 0. Here we have p in the denominator, we have to replace it by the value. But still, if you replace this p with the actual value, that is this value, still you will have to equate this part of this equation to 0, you will get the maximum. So in that case, when this is equating to 0, that means twice v square vr is equal to 4 vr cube. That means vr should be equal to vs divided by root of 2. That means when vr is equal to vs by 2, the maximum power will be transferred to the consider resistance. Putting the value of vr, which is called vs by 2 in the power equation, that is in this equation, so it will be equal to vs square minus vs square by 2 into vs by 2 divided by x effect 2. So vs square by 2 minus vs square by 2, it will be equal to vs square by 2, square root, taking square root of both of them, it will be equal to vs square by root 2. This will be vs square by root 2, sorry, vs square, vs by root 2. Total will be equal to vs square by 2 into x effect 2, it will be equal to x into 1 minus k. When vs is equal to vr is equal to v, it will be equal to v square into 2 into x into 1 minus k. Now put the value of replace this vs by sorry, replace with this vs, or we can say vs by root 2 by vr. So here we have vs square by 2, so it has to be replaced by vr square, because when you square it, both sides will be vr square is equal to vs square by 2. So vr square by 2 will be equal to this value, or from this equation, this will be twice p, or you can see here, vs equal to, vs will be equal to 2 p into 1 minus k square. This will be value of the vs. So when you replace this vs by vr, that is vr has to be, vs by root 2 will be equal to vr. So this 2 will go, so vr will be equal to root of p into 1 minus k into x. So we can rewrite this equation, p is equal to vr square divided by 1 minus k. That is this equation, when you replace this vr, vs square by 2 by vr, it will be equal to vr square by 1 minus k, which is equal to vs square by 2 into 1 minus k. So from this, you see that we'll be using this equation, because vr is itself variable. So this is constant. So this actually gives you the value of p at which we have a maximum value of p. Actually, this is maximum. So this is the graph of this equation. Which equation? This equation. P is equal to this, where x-axis is the vr and y-axis is p. You can see x-axis is the vr and y-axis is p. So this curve is actually the same curve, but in this case x-axis is p and y-axis is vr. So it is shown, we can say, it has been shifted toward by 90 degrees. So the curves will be like this. From here also you can see that when vs is equal to vr, this is p. This is vs is equal to, sorry, vr is equal to 0. This is vr is equal to vs, this value. This is vr is equal to vs by 2. at both at this point and this point, this power will be equal to zero. At this point, this power will be equal to maximum. That is also shown by this. Now we'll be using this equation. Since Vs is constant at the source side, this Vr may vary as a function of P, but we will be using this equation. You can see from here the value of power, that is real power, at which this voltage will go down, or we can say it will come down and go back. That means this point is the instability voltage point. This point is the instability voltage point. This point is the instability voltage point for this. So as k increases in this equation, you will see that the power increases, and this is that power at which we can say critical amount of power at which voltage becomes, or above which the voltage becomes unstable. After that, if you increase the power slightly beyond this value, the voltage will go on decreasing and it will finally reach to zero. This is the unstable point. So it means this equation is very important to determine the value of the power, which makes the voltage stable even if you are increasing this power. So it depends upon the value of K. You can see this is the value of K at K is equal to zero. This is the value of K at K is equal to 0.5. This is the value of K is equal to 0.75. You can see this power goes on increasing. This power goes on increasing as K increases, or we can say this system is more stable in voltage as compared to this system. This system is more stable in voltage than this system. This is actually the same graph for which I have taken from the book. That's because you may not understand this graph by first calculating the other things. I first drawn it this way and then this way. This is the same graph. This is XC is equal to 0. You can see P is equal to 1 per unit for this unstable portion. Then P is here 2 when X is equal to 0.2. P is equal to 2 per unit. Here P may be equal to more than, you can say, 4 per unit when X is equal to 0.7. So I hope you understood this. So for the time being, I'll stop over here. We'll continue with the next class. Okay, thank you.